Today I am going to start a new subject, that is the analog communication. Now analog communication involves the study of communication engineering in analog domain. What is communication? Communication is nothing but the transmission of information from one point to another point. Those points may be distant point, that means when we cannot convey the information physically through voice or by sending anything physically, we can use the electrical or optical signals to convey the information to the distant end. Now, communications may have two different modes. One is called the broadcasting mode, another is called the point-to-point mode. Okay, so what is broadcasting mode? Broadcasting mode means there will be one transmitter or signal generation point from which the information will be broadcasted or sent. Okay, and there will be multiple receivers or vicinity or distant points who can receive those information which is transmitted by the broadcasting transmitter. So it is nothing but a one to many point transmission. So it is the broadcasting mode. Examples are commercial radio or TV transmission. Second type of mode is the point to point mode. For this case, one particular transmitter will be sending the information and another transmitter will receive that information. That means information sent by the sender will be designated for a particular receiver. So this is the point to point mode. Examples are telephonic or mobile conversation. Okay, so there are two types of modes which have been discussed. Now I am going to discuss the basic communication model. What are the different components will be there in a basic communication system? First of all, the left side, the left side of the communication system model will have a source of information. If we consider it is a voice communication system, then the source of information will be nothing but a transducer or sensor which will convert the acoustic voice signal of the speaker into the equivalent electrical vibration or electrical signal. Okay, that is called the message signal, as it is mentioned here. It is the information bearing message signal, which is one electrical signal if you consider the electrical communication system. If you consider the optical communication system, then this message signal will have the form of optical signal. Okay, now let me consider the next step or the next module, which is the transmitter. Transmitter will simply transmit this electrical signal. I am considering the electrical communication system. Okay, this electrical signal will be transmitted by the transmitter. This is the transmitted signal, which is electrical, and this signal will be transmitted through a physical media. This physical media is called the channel. Okay, this physical media may be wired media or unguided media, guided or unguided media. Guided media example is like one copper wire, okay, through which the electrical signal can pass, and unguided media may be the wireless media or the air or vacuum. Okay, within the channel there may be several electrical disturbances. Those are called the noise, which will be simply added to the electrical signal which is transmitted and causes distortion. Okay, so it is called the noise. Noise is undesirable. We have to design the communication system in such a way that noise will be minimum at the receiver end. Okay, there will be several systems like filtering or any other noise cancellation systems by which we can reduce the amount of noise power which is added in the channel with the electrical signal, transmitted electrical signal. Okay, after that, that signal will reach the receiver. It is the receiver end, and the receiver, after receiving the signal, it will be transferred to the output transducer, which may be the speaker in case of the electrical communication. Okay, speaker will reconvert the electrical signal into equivalent acoustic signal, which is audible by any human being. Okay, so acoustic signal from the sender end will be transferred to a distant point to a receiver. Okay, and this distance point, the distance of this sender to the receiver will dependent on the design of the communication system. It may be 1 kilometer, it may be 100 meters, it may be 10 kilometers, etc., depending on the type of the communication system. Now let me classify the communication systems by means of several parameters. First classification is the classification of communication in terms of the physical media, type of the physical media. Communication system may be classified into either guided communication or unguided or free space communication. Guided communication may be landline telephone, where the copper wires are used to transmit the signal from transmitter to receiver. It may be the LAN, local area network. It may be the optical fiber for optical communication, etc. Okay, there must be some physical media in case of the guided communication, which media will guide the signal to reach from the transmitter to receiver. Unguided or free space communication is nothing but wireless communication, where signals will be simply transmitted to the air medium or vacuum medium, and that electromagnetic wave may reach the receiver end, which will be received and reconstructed. Okay, so examples are radio, television broadcasting, etc., microwave links, okay, satellite communication, etc. Remember, next classification is the classification in terms of the nature of the signal energy. Now signal energy may be used in the communication either of electrical type or the optical type. For the electrical type signal, the communication system is called the electrical communication system, and if you use the optical type signal for sharing the information, those are called the optical communication system. Next classification is in terms of the nature of the signal type. Okay, it is very important. Number A is the analog communication. If the transmitted signal is the analog in nature, then it is called the analog communication. Conversely, if the transmitted signal is digital in nature, then it is called the digital communication. You already know what is analog communication, what is analog signal and what is digital signal from your earlier study of signal systems. Let me briefly explain again. Analog, for analog signals, there will be no limit on the how many number of values can be taken by the signals. Okay, those are the analog signals, and when the analog signal is used to transmit the information, then it is called the analog communication, which will be studied in this particular curriculum. And digital signal means where there will be some restriction on the values which can be used to represent a signal. It may be two values which is predefined. It may be 0 volt and 5 volt. Two steps may be used to represent a signal, then it is called a binary signal. If M array signal means M number of signal values may be used to represent a particular signal, then it is called a digital communication signal. Okay, and for that case, if you use the digital signal in your communication, then it is called a digital communication. Digital communication will be taught in the next semester. To our concern in this curriculum is the analog communication. Okay, some examples of the communication systems: telegraph communication, which is ancient form of communication by which we can send text from one end to other end via some particular coding technique.
especially Morse coding technique, etc. Radio communication, which is analog in nature. Telephone communication, which is analog in nature. Nowadays, some of the telephone communication is using the digital communication techniques. Television communication, initially it was used the analog communication techniques, but nowadays all the television broadcastings are done in the digital domain. Computer networks, digital communication, satellite communication, digital communication, and optical fiber communication. It is especially one very upcoming and modern technique of high speed communication system, and which especially use the digital communication. Okay. The primary resources of communication and the operational requirements. One thing you must know that transmitted power and channel bandwidth, these are the two parameters which are the primary resources of communication. Now, what is the transmitted power? Average power of the transmitted signal is the transmitted power. Remember that if the average power of the transmitted signal is very high, then signal can reach to very distant end. Okay. So, amount of transmitted power will be proportional to the coverage of the communication. Next one is the channel bandwidth. Channel bandwidth means physical media through which the signal is sent. The bandwidth of that channel is called the channel bandwidth. Now, larger bandwidth means higher speed signal or larger amount of information can be sent, and narrower bandwidth means we have to send lower bandwidth signal through that particular channel. Okay, width of the pass band of the channel is nothing but the channel bandwidth. Now, these two are the resources of communication. One thing you must know that there must be some trade-off in between the transmitted power and channel bandwidth, which will be discussed later in order to design a communication system. Some examples of power limited channels and band limited channels are given here. See that these are the power limited channel. Number one is the wireless channel. Transmitted power should be low in order to obtain prolonged battery life, because we know that wireless channels uses generally some devices as receivers, which is powered by the batteries. It may be the 1000 ampere hour battery or milliampere hour battery or 2000, 3000 or 5000, etc. Milliampere batteries are used in your mobile telephones in order to power those transceivers. And if the transmitted power is very high, then this kind of power, this amount of power cannot be handled by such low power battery systems. Okay, that's why the transmitted power should be as low as possible for this kind of wireless channels in order to support the prolonged battery life. Okay, satellite channels, only solar power is available in the satellites, which will used to transmit the channel back to the earth. Okay, so that's why the satellite channels must use considerably low power, otherwise it cannot be supported by the solar power. Next is the deep space links. Extremely limited power is available, because in case of the deep space links, solar power availability is also very small. That's why this kind of transmitter should use very low power. Okay. And band limited channels, telephone channels. In case of the telephone channels, at a particular instant, different number of calls, that means multiple number of calls may be simultaneously going on. That's why it is nothing but a multi-user environment. Requirement is to minimize the frequency band allotted to the transmitter of each voice signal. Okay, so that's why ensuring the quality of the service for each user is maintained. Generally, remember that since it is the multi-user environment, that's why each user should be allotted by a particular bandwidth, okay, which will be a
portion of the total bandwidth available for this particular service. Suppose telephone communication, suppose we are considering the mobile communication, okay. First GSM band have the bandwidth starting from the 800 megahertz up to the 900 megahertz. Total 100 megahertz bandwidth is available for providing the band 1 GSM service. If a particular, within a particular region, 100 users are involved in a call, then what will be the available bandwidth for each user? It will be 100 by 100, that will be 1 megahertz per user. So remember that those all channels which are allotted to a particular user should be limited in nature. It should not be unlimited. Otherwise, a single user will occupy the entire band. That's why this is a an example of the band limited channel. Again, the television and radio channels are also bandwidth, because the total service bandwidth is limited, and each channel or each band broadcasting station must be occupied by a finite amount of bandwidth. Otherwise, it will interfere with the other service providers or other broadcasting stations. Okay. Now, one important aspect of the communication is the noise. What is noise? Noise is unwanted fluctuation of signals that tend to disturb the quality of the received signal. Okay. Actually, noise is introduced by two different ways. One is called the external noise, another is called the internal noise. External noise is inherent to channel. You cannot control the amount of external noise. And internal noise is inherent to the receiver. You can control, you can have some control over the internal noise. Now, external noise, which is added to the signal in the channel, cannot be avoided, because you cannot have the control over the entire channel. Okay, but internal noise within the receiver, by using certain sophisticated circuits or sophisticated systems, you can reduce the internal noise as much as possible. Okay, now thing is that there is a parameter by which you can measure the performance of the receiver, that is called the, or any communication component, that is called the signal to noise ratio. It is nothing but a ratio of signal power PS divided by the noise power. Okay, both should be in the same unit. Suppose signal power is in watt unit, then the noise power should be also in the watt unit. So signal power divided by the noise power is, it is an unitless quantity. It is called the signal to noise ratio. And generally, signal to noise ratio should be as high as possible for a communication system in order to get the better performance. Generally, the signal to noise ratio is presented or defined in the decibel unit. Okay, that means 10 log 10 base PS by PN dB. dB is the decibel. Generally, this decibel unit is used to represent the signal to noise ratio, which we'll discuss in detail later in this curriculum. Okay. Now, one important aspect I am coming to is the modulation and demodulation. What is modulation? What is demodulation techniques? These are two important techniques which is used in any communication system in order to make communication to be secured, to be tell you what is modulation, what is demodulation. Okay, now look at this block diagram. This is the input side, input signal, that is the information. Okay, there is an input transducer, as I mentioned earlier. Suppose it is the voice communication, so input transducer will be simply the microphone. Okay, it will convert the acoustic voice signal into the equivalent electrical signal. Okay, if it is the optical communication, it will be the optical signal. Let me consider the electrical communication. So input signal or the information will be converted to the electrical communication by means of a mic or microphone. Next is the modulation. Modulator, this block is called the modulator. modulation is a technique by which actually we will translate the frequency of the input signal or the message to higher frequency level. Okay, that higher frequency is called the carrier signal, which will just carry the signal to distant end. There will be a carrier signal which is sinusoidal in nature, having a single frequency, suppose fc, and which is much greater than the frequency or the highest frequency of the input signal. Okay, now suppose the voice communication, for that case bandwidth of the voice frequency is starting from the 20 hertz up to 20 kilohertz. Now we can assume that it is starting from 0 to 20 kilohertz, so total bandwidth of the message signal is 20 kilohertz. It is a baseband signal, and now you know that lower frequency signals cannot reach to very far end, though it is electrical or optical nature. So somehow you have to increase the frequency of the message signal or translate the frequency spectrum of the message signal to a higher frequency range in order to get the greater coverage. Modulator do the same, which will just translate the frequency spectrum of the message signal into higher frequency spectrum, which is centered at the fc, that is the frequency of the carrier signal. Okay, and since now the all frequency components of the message signal is at the megahertz or gigahertz level, then it can that is why it can transferred, simply transmitted to very far end. Okay, so that's why long distance communication is possible. So modulator is that which translate the upward, which will give the upward shift of the information at the transmitter end. After the modulator, the upward shifted upward frequency shifted signal will be transmitted via an antenna. Okay, it will pass through the channel, some noise will be introduced into the signal, and it will be received at the receiver end. Okay, now there will be a demodulator at the beginning of the receiver. Demodulator is just the reciprocal operation of the modulator. Demodulator will do the reciprocal operation of the modulator. Okay, the technique is called the demodulation. Demodulation will retranslate the higher frequency transmitted signal into the audible frequency range. That means it will retranslate the megahertz level or gigahertz level of the transmitted signal into the voice frequency range, that is the 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz range. Okay, that is called the demodulated signal. Okay, again this particular operation will be done through a particular, the same carrier signal which is used in the transmitter. Okay, that carrier signal should have the same frequency, that is the fc. So fc will retranslate the or down translate the received signal at the receiver end to the voice frequency range, and it will be fed to the output transducer. Output transducer is nothing but the speaker for the voice communication, and it will now convert the electrical signal into the acoustic signal, which is audible to the human being. Okay, so it is the process. So modulation and demodulation is generally used to increase the distance of coverage. Now there are some different advantages of the modulation technique. First of all, number one, to increase the distance of coverage, which I have already discussed, lower frequency cannot propagate it to very far distance. It will have higher attenuation in the air or vacuum medium or any other physical medium. But if you increase the frequency by means of modulation, then it can reach to very far end. And as we increase the frequency, the distance of coverage will increase up to a certain point. Okay, so that's why first advantages of the modulation or needs of the modulation is the increase the distance of coverage. Next, avoiding the mixing of the signals. Now what is it, mixing of the signals? See that for any communication system, suppose I am considering the point to point communication, multi-user environment, mobile communication, then several transmitters are transmitting several signals, and those are all designated to particular receivers. Okay, so user 1 is transmitted some signal and it is designated for user 2. user 3 is transmitting some signal which is designated for transmitter, sorry, user 4. Okay, so now if both user 1 transmitted signal and user 3 transmitted signal will have the same frequency spectrum, then after transmitting both of them simultaneously in the air medium, both will be added together, and at the receiver ends, both the user 2 and user 4 will receive the mixture of those two signals. Okay, that's why they cannot separate them, and there will be totally mesh up, and no effective communication is possible. So what you have to do, you have to do the modulation of user 1 signal and user 3 signal by means of two different carrier signals. Okay, FC1 will be provided to the user 1, whose signal will be modulated by FC1, and FC2 will be provided to user 3, which will be modulated by the user 3, and both FC1 and FC3 should be very much separated, so that the two signals should not mix to each other in the channel region, that means the air media. Okay, that is called the multiplexing. We are actually using the same physical media, suppose air, in between two user communications, user 1 to user 2 and user 3 to user 4, but both of them are using two different carrier signals, that's why their signals are not mixing at the channel. So in order to avoid the mixing of the signals, we have to use the modulation techniques. If you don't use the modulation, then all of the signals, for case of the various communication, all of the signals will be transmitted within the spectrum of 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, and all of them will be mixed within the air media, and no efficient reconstruction is possible. Third point is the to support the multiplexing, which I have just discussed. Multiplexing means sharing of the single channel by means of several users, okay, by means of the communication having different carrier frequencies, we can share the single channel by the several users, that is called the multiplexing, which have been just discussed. Okay, I will elaborate it in my next topic, just wait. Okay, next is the upward frequency translation reduces the antenna length, the fourth point. See that antenna length is generally proportional to the lambda by 2. Lambda is the wavelength of the transmitted signal. Lambda is C by F, that means the velocity of light divided by the frequency of the signal. Now see that if the larger frequency is used, then the lambda value will be very small. If the smaller frequencies are used, then the lambda value will be very large. Now if we consider we want to send the voice signal by means of the simple, without modulation, you want to send the voice signal, your voice signal range is up to 20 kilohertz. If you convert the 20 kilohertz into corresponding wavelength, you will find that the wavelength is coming in the kilometer order. Okay, that's why antenna length should be very long. It is not possible to implement an antenna which is certain kilometers long, okay, or hundreds of meters long. To maintain or to transmit a signal through such long antenna for a single user communication is not feasible. So you have to reduce the length of the antenna to make the physical communication. So what you have to do, you have to somehow translate your frequency of the message to a very large amount of frequency, so that that frequency may be in the order of megahertz range or gigahertz range, so that this particular wavelength of the signal reduces to either centimeter range or meter range. Okay, so that antenna size may be realistic. Okay, so in order to get the realistic antenna size, you have to use the modulation or upward shift of the signal. Okay, next is the some extent of protection against the unauthorized detection. See that for the communication, point to point communication, you need to have certain amount of protection. That means you should not, it is not desired that your transmitted signal will be received by or reconstructed by some unauthorized person. Your transmitted signal should be designated for a particular receiver. Okay. So if you transmit your signal by using a modulation technique which uses a particular carrier frequency which is unknown to any other person, then your signal will be securely transmitted. If the FC value is unknown to any other receiver, then how can those receivers demodulate your signal? Okay. So by providing a particular FC which is unknown to all other receivers, you are providing actually some amount of security. So it is some protection against the unauthorized detection. It is providing some protection. Okay. The sixth point is to improve the quality of reception. Simply, the higher frequency signals generally propagates through the medium or the channel with less amount of noise, and those are actually provides the better quality of the received signal at the receiver end. If you use the lower frequency signals, larger amount of noise will be that signal will be larger noise affected, and the dependency of the frequency on the noise will be discussed later in this curriculum. Okay, remember that if you use the higher frequency communication, then the quality of the received signal will be better. If you use the lower frequency communication system, then the quality will be reduced. Okay, so these are the six points which elaborates the needs of the modulation. Okay, and modulation and demodulation techniques just reciprocal to each other. Modulation provides the upward shift or upward translation of the information, and demodulation just down converts the received signal into the original message signal. Okay. Next is the I'm just going to elaborate the multiplexing technique. Multiplexing, here we are considering about the FDM, frequency division multiplexing. Okay. Now see that. Let me first consider three users are there having this kind of signals. Okay, this kind of three signals. Let me first tell me the frequency spectrum of a modulated signal. It is the baseband signal, which is nothing but a information signal. Okay, suppose it is the voice signal, starting from 0 up to FM. For the voice signal, this FM value is 20 kilohertz. Now it is the band or the frequency band of the message signal. Okay. Now consider the carrier signal. See that carrier signal has a single frequency. In the frequency domain, it has just a single spike. It is a sinusoidal signal. Okay. Now if you modulate this information signal with this carrier signal, what will happen? It will cause this kind of signal. That means the message signal is translated from 0 to FM to starting from FC to FC plus FM. Okay, this is called the upper sideband, and again this same thing will be replicated here also. There is a mirror image of the upper sideband. It is called the lower sideband. It is starting from FC and extended up to FC minus FM. So this total information spectrum will be mirrored around the both sides of the carrier signal. It is the carrier signal and it is the upper sideband, which is nothing but the information signal. Again it is the lower sideband, which is nothing but the information signal. Again both are mirrored here. These are the redundant. Okay, now see that now the bandwidth of the it is the modulated signal. After modulation you will get this, and bandwidth of the modulated signal, the lowermost frequency is the FC minus FM and uppermost frequency is the FC plus FM. So what is the bandwidth? FC plus FM minus FC minus FM, it will be 2 FM. Okay, it is the amplitude modulation which will be discussed later. See that for this case the frequency, each component of the frequency is translated to the higher end. So modulation actually translate the signal to the higher frequency domain. Okay, now let us consider the multiplexing, frequency division multiplexing. required, we are considering three users, user 1, user 2 and user 3. For simplicity, I am showing three different shapes of the information spectrum. Of user 1, it has this kind of shape, user 2, it has this kind of triangular shape, and user 3, these have certain different shape. Okay. And we are modulating user 1 signal by means of FC1, one particular carrier signal. User 2 signal is modulated by FC2, another carrier signal, which is separated from well separated from the earlier carrier signal. Okay. User 3 signal is modulated by FC3, which is again well separated from the FC2, and it is a different carrier signal. Okay. Another user may be there, which has this kind of shape of its information spectrum, and again it will be modulated by another carrier signal, which is FC4, which is well separated from the FC3. See that after modulation in the frequency domain, all these four signals are separated by certain frequency range, and those are not actually mixed. Okay. At the receiver end, this particular spectrum will be chosen and demodulated. It will get the user 1 signal. At the receiver end, corresponding to the receiver 2, by means of the FC2, this amount of spectrum will be demodulated and it will get the user 2 signal. At the receiver corresponding to the user 3, this spectrum will be demodulated by means of the FC3, and it will get the reconstruction of the user 3 signal. Similarly, for the user 4, receiver corresponding to the user 4 will demodulate the signal corresponding to the by using the FC4, and it will get the information reconstruction of the user 4 signal. So by means of modulation, we are avoiding the mixing of the signals. But if you send all these signals without any modulation, then see that range of all these signals are starting from 0 to FM. So after transmitting all of them simultaneously without modulation, all of them will be added, and at the receiver ends you cannot separate them. This is the conception of multiplexing. You have to separate each user signal in the frequency domain in order to transmit them simultaneously, and we are actually using this whole amount of channel bandwidth by sharing between four different users. That's why it is called the multiplexing. And since this sharing is done on the basis of the frequency spectrum, that's why this is called the frequency division multiplexing. Okay. So these are all about the introductory part of the analog communication or the communication systems. In my next class, I will start the different modulation techniques. Okay. Initially, we will start the amplitude modulation, and afterwards I will start the angular modulation, which is more complex than the amplitude modulation. Okay. So far.